We begin the thing with a universal picture. White lettering over black, unusual because usually they have the universal logo. Now we're starting the credit sequence in the first movie of what I call my apocalypse trilogy. The Thing, Prince of Darkness, and The Mouth of Madness. And sitting next to me here today is Kurt Russell.
Yeah, this is fun. Check this out again. I haven't seen this movie for quite a while. One thing I really remember about this movie, John, was when we came onto the lot at Universal, they had a big welcome sign for Burt Reynolds and Dolly Parton. And I thought, yeah, boy, we're in trouble now.
That was the best little whorehouse in Texas.
Yeah, best little whorehouse in Texas.
So I wanted to do something with the credit sequence here, but it didn't work out because of the DGA and the contract in terms of everybody having their name linked together to the title. But originally I wanted to have the movie start with the saucer coming through space, heading towards the Earth, and the title burning out. But I had to put all these titles in instead, so it was a little strange opening. But it worked out all right.
A little different monster for the audience. Wasn't this the same year that E.T. came out?
As a matter of fact, we came out 2 weeks after E.T. came out.
That's what it was.
And theirs was sweet and ours was mean. Now, you're going to see in a minute the main title burn through. It's exactly the same as the original Thing. We copied their logo exactly. Peter Coran did this model flying through here, this shot and this one. Excellent kind of beginning. This is the crash of the saucer back in the, I guess, before man was on the Earth. It goes down into Antarctica. And here we come, and we're underway. We did this movie right after Escape from New York, didn't we?
I was going to say, we did Escape in 1980, is that right?
Yeah, it was released in 81.
And then we did this in
81.
81.
This was released in 82.
So this is the third time that you and I had worked together, because we did Elvis before Escape.
We did Elvis, and then we did Escape from New York, and then The Thing. And there we are, Antarctica, winter 1982, and we began the film. We shot this opening up in Alaska, in the ice fields above Juneau. And we started shooting this in June 1st of 1981. We were up there a couple of weeks, and we didn't realize when we got there that there are not many clear days, because when it gets foggy, when the clouds come in over the sun, well, you can't see anything. So the crew spent a lot of time on sleds going down the glacier and getting sunburned. Now, one of the men inside this helicopter was our first assistant director and your brother-in-law at the time, Larry Franco. And there he is leading out. We used a helicopter mount. We used a car mount on this. It was one of the first times it had been done. Kind of an unusual feel to it.
Now, the set was built in the summertime, wasn't it? So that there could be snow on the, snow on the roof.
That's right. And this is a vast area up above Juneau, Alaska. This is really where all the weather patterns for the United States, forms up in here.
Yeah, wasn't this supposed to be the place where there was more snow than any other place?
Than any other place ever. Now we're into the dog, and the basic idea behind all this, of course, now that we know, is that the thing has already struck a Norwegian camp, and now it's on its way to the American camp. And all this was second unit photography. I was up there.
Were you flying that helicopter? Or?
I was not. I hadn't learned to fly yet, but this was one of the experiences that made me want to learn.
That got you.
Was being there's Larry Franco about to take a shot. And since he was supposed to play a Norwegian, he made up some dialogue. Smergsdorf. Yeah. The only problem with this location was we couldn't get any beer. And so we tried to send the helicopters back down to Juneau to get beer and bring it up to us. But the
locals didn't help you out much there.
They didn't help us out too much.
That's cold, boy.
It is. It really is. And now in a second here, we're going to cut to our set at the glacier in British Columbia. There we go. Oh, ma. There we are. It's cold. It's awful. So here we're setting up our Antarctic station, and your character, who we're about to introduce now, MacReady, the helicopter pilot, likes to have a drink of J&B, but also he was fairly isolated out there. Didn't we talk about the Vietnam helicopter?
Yeah, he was that he had some experience and was probably an alcoholic now. And what was interesting about it was that here was this guy who was up in Antarctica with all these other guys who had their own problems for wanting to be up there. But this guy had to get a little further away than most. So here's a man with a problem in his chessboard.
He was a true loner, and I felt a character who never wanted to assume the leadership role and was forced into it through circumstance.
And I remember that when I came on board with you, the hat was already established because of second unit stuff. That's great.
The big hat was something I really enjoyed. I don't know how you felt about it. But
well, I had to live with it. I had to learn to love it.
I appreciate that. So we're back up in Alaska for this particular sequence. We had the dog you see running here is not the dog we ended up using. Jed is the dog who was the thing dog in the later parts. But this is a double. He's kind of painted like Jed. Well, he didn't like this particular moment. Right there, the dog ducks because the helicopter is really only about 5 feet above him.
That's amazing flying, isn't it, when you know how impossible it is to determine where you are in these, all the weight.
These bush pilots we had up there are pretty wild guys. I mean,
what was it we called him? Lawrence of Alaska?
Lawrence of Alaska was up there. This was the guy who was flying this. You went up one time, and he gave you the controls, and off you went.
We took this was all on a. I remember we were warned because this was all very near an edge, and it was impossible to tell. Some days, one step being the next, that would be fine, and taking us one another for step, and you'd be falling about 500 feet.
Here's some of the cast gathering together there.
So. Keith David and David Clennon and Charlie Hallahan, and I couldn't tell if that was.
I think it's Peter Maloney was the other one. So here goes Nate, the helicopter pilot, into a kind of a thunderhead there. He comes around, and Larry Franco again opens up
Swedish.
A little bomb.
What is it? Was he Norwegian?
Yeah, he was Norwegian.
Norwegian
and we have
bomb.
A little shot here that he drops the bomb. We couldn't set off the explosion under the chopper, so it comes a little late there, but otherwise it worked pretty well. Nate does a quick stop on the helicopter, pulls back like that. He's coming up, you can't really see him, he's coming up on the ledge, a shelf.
Yeah.
And he sets it down. And we're about to get our story underway.
I remember looking at that shot reminds me of me forgetting to bring my skis up there. It was fantastic skiing, and nobody brought skis. That's Charlie, and yeah, that's
and there
Maloney.
You are.
I joined him there.
We all developed a real camaraderie working together
in
the middle of nowhere. We had some adventures that I think we really can't talk about here on this laser disc for fear.
We had a hell of a time just getting there on that bus, I can tell you that much.
You were yelling at the actors, getting them to put it back on the road.
We had to get out of the bus and turn the bus. We had to push the front end of the bus around. It was so icy that we were able to do it. Norbert
was very, very fluent in Norwegian, and off we go here. At the time this movie was released, this would have been in June of '82. It was considered a very frightening and horrifying and repellent film, but now we look at it, and it's kind of a straightforward, tough, hard-hitting action picture with a monster in it. Really, our concern was about the paranoia aspects of the story.
A great story about that, wasn't it? 12 guys and finally getting and knowing each other so well, and then finally getting to a point where you don't know.
The original short story was called "Who Goes There," and I think that sort of sums up the idea: are you human, or who are you?
And the original thing didn't have much to do with the original short
That's
story.
That's
right.
It was a monster, like Frankenstein was a monster.
So you decided to go back to that.
Let's go back to the short story and explore it. I thought it had never been really told. So now we've shot the Norwegian without really knowing what's going on. Here you guys are actually putting out this mock-up we set on fire. And we started using some transitional devices here between this scene and the next one. Sometimes we do fades to white. Whiteouts, and sometimes we do blackouts, and depending on the mood, we wanted to.
That's Richard Masser.
Masser's coming up to talk to the dog, who's very nervous because we're all standing there as a camera crew. It's real cold, as you can see. And the set was built by John Lloyd up there. Now I think we're going to go into a transition here. We did a lot of improvisation and rewriting when we got up to British Columbia to try to clarify some points in the picture.
I remember it was so difficult to tell on film who was who because...
The characters are so many of them. I think Bill Lancaster, who wrote the screenplay, did a terrific job, but I probably screwed up as a director and not differentiating. Peter Maloney and Richard Dysart are in this scene together. And... both very fine actors.
Tom Waits.
And here comes Wilford. Will Brimley, who is one of the great all-time people.
Yeah, they broke the mold there, didn't they?
And Will is the real thing. Yeah, I mean, he's it's impossible for Will to ever do anything phony. He's really who he is.
He's a long way from those oatmeal commercials here, isn't he?
God, I have a real affection for Will. He's a terrific guy. So we're in the sets at Universal here, and here comes TK on his roller skates, and we're about to get into our first kind of big dialogue scene.
He's a funny guy, TK.
He's constantly worried that all of us were racists. He was very, very worried about it.
He is funny. I've seen TK a number of times since then, and I must say, he's just a joy. And there's Keith David there in the back.
And Joel Polis is over there. Various characters who are up, basically down in Antarctica, working at a scientific institute. And David Clennon, who usually plays the lawyer, got to play kind of a mechanic who wants to be a helicopter pilot. So his idea for a character was he got out of drug rehab, and and he's now trying to be trying to live a real life.
I remember taking Keith and TK down to this hider to get
hiderized.
Yeah.
I still in my wallet right now at this moment. I have my hiderization card.
I've never felt my throat close off faster than that.
I was near death when I got hiderized. Hiderized is basically you have to drink down Everclear, and then they light the glass on fire. It's pretty wild. This is real snow in a real storm. We had some unpleasant shooting times up in British Columbia. I fell asleep one night, and it was around 30 degrees below zero with a wind chill. There's a nice whiteout transition, and we're into the next scene. And really, one of the dangers, Kurt, as I remember, is a whiteout. We actually got stuck in one trying
to get
down the hill.
That's right. I forgot about that. You were in one helicopter. I was in another one.
We were on our way to punch in until the pilot found his way back. And then we had to ride down in the bus.
I remember you talking about that from having talked with the helicopter pilots about it, and I thought, how bad could a whiteout be until we got into that one, and I realized there was absolutely no visibility, zero visibility.
It's like being in the inside of a ping pong ball trying to find your way out of it. And
I think this is where I got the...
This is the incredible scene where what we have in the helicopter is a dual control system, and you're in one seat, and the real pilot's in the other. And he's lifting you up, and then all of a sudden gives you the controls of the helicopter,
right.
And you see it sort of start to wobble.
It did. That ground fell away fast, though. Boy, it went from 5 feet to 5,000 feet pretty quick.
Here you are, and he's in the left seat, and you're looking around, and you're going to pull it in and take it up. You really have your hands on the controls here. He's helping you get off. There you go.
It looked like I was flying
there
without taking control of it.
And at some point here, he gives the control to you. I thought it was actually... pretty good maneuver.
We'll see. Oops, I got it now.
And he's pulling in a lot of power to come up around there. The pilots we worked with were bush pilots in Alaska, and they were fearless, kind of wild men. I remember the pilot we had in Alaska offered to crash the helicopter for money. So now we're into kind of a quiet sequence as we discover the dog has a secret. And one of the great parts of working with Jed, the dog, was that once he got to know the crew, you could do a dolly shot with him, and he would not look at the camera or the director or the crew. And really amazing work for an animal. There's a shot coming up in a minute.
This is TK's domain, huh?
TK's domain, now we're kind of shooting the sets. I think also one of the problems was to make the location realistic. It's really a kind of prefabbed building that they would have, and the rooms look a lot identical.
And you had to be able to blow the, I remember you had to be able to blow the actual structure up, and we were living in it a lot of the time.
Yes.
So it was always 31 degrees.
And it was extremely cold. Here comes the dog. This is quite an amazing shot when you realize that he's doing this all by himself. The dog hesitates at the door. He's not looking at the camera. He looks in. He stops. He checks out somebody in another room. He pauses, then moves. He doesn't look at us as we pull back.
Look at that, yeah.
Then he stops and stares.
Look at that.
Waits, and in he goes. Amazing work for an animal.
How many times did you guys do that?
4 or 5.
He
was really, really good. Fade out. Now we're into a second unit shot here. We have a Bell Jet Ranger going by, and yet when we cut to the interior shot, we are actually in an A-Star because we had 2 helicopters on location, and through the A-Star, coming up here in a second, it goes bang. You have more view through the front window.
I see.
The helicopter pilot, you are in the right seat, but it's really the pilot, and these are...
A second unit shot?
Second unit shot. And now we're back in British Columbia. And we've already blown up the compound for the end. And here you come landing in, you and Dysart. So we had to revamp the set to make it into the Norwegian set. Now you see what a helicopter looks like when it comes down really quick. It hits the wind and the heat, and it spins around a little, and down he comes. A lot of power from those rotors, and he sets it down, and... In a minute, we're going to go onto the soundstage at Universal, and John Lloyd's sets, I must tell you, in this sequence were just gorgeous.
It was so weird, too, because it was so hot. I remember it was 105 degrees outside in Los Angeles, and it was the exact opposite of what you experience when you go into a walk-in freezer, because it was so hot outside that when you went into the set, where it usually is warmer than inside, it was colder. And it was, 28 degrees with the misters?
We had water in the air, the only way to get breath, yeah. And yet you still had to put coffee and hot liquid in your mouth to get it.
Remember
to
those
work.
Little baskets we had once in a while? We had little baskets with dry ice in them. We had to keep moving them around in our mouth.
So you're about to come up to our there we are, an interior set now. And Dean Cundey's lighting is spectacular here. The value difference between the snow and the outside light and the interior lights are very moody. And... this is your basic kind of haunted house walk. Was a lot longer originally in the script, but we cut it down to move the story forward. And you make some discoveries here that later on are going to aid us in the story. It's a very beautiful shot. Here you have the a lot of contrast in Dean's lighting. He did an incredible job.
Really did. It was a great look on this picture. And this stuff was tough to do because everybody got sick from those misters and from being cold. It got to be a grind, didn't it? This got to be a little bit of a grind with the flares and the smoke and the cold.
This was tough. I have to admit, this was a tough show. It wasn't pleasant physically. And we were all pretty tired. The music that's going here is from a composer that I've been an admirer of, Ennio Morricone. Mm-hmm. And it's a full orchestral score. It's very beautiful. And now we're up to Rob Bottin's first... a rubber effect shot, and I remember when we all first shot this, we were rather dubious as to whether this was going to work. It actually turned out all right.
It looks pretty different in real life than it does on film, doesn't it?
It sure does. In real life, we all thought, my God, what is this? But we managed to capture on film the idea that a man is frozen, he's committed suicide, and he slashed his wrist, and the blood is frozen really fast. You do freeze pretty quickly there. But when we all saw this on the set, we thought, oh, Lord, this is not going to work.
I remember Rob always coming in, it seemed like, with more of that gel. He said, well, it's going to be fine, John. As soon as I put the gel on, it's going to come to life.
We used Carbapol, which is the ingredient in Twinkies that holds it together. That was our slime. And Rob was discovering what the monster was as we were making the film, so we had an occasional... on-set experience that was rather depressing. We'll get into that later, but here you are into another section of the set, and you're about to walk into one of my favorite moments. It's a nod of the hat to the original film, In Hawks' version, they brought in this big block of ice, and the thing gets out of it. So we wanted to put a block of ice in ours. Right. You discover it in another room. This is all phony snow, and it worked pretty well. Roy Arbogast was our on-set special effects man. Did a terrific job.
That was tough to do. I remember a lot of dialogue about that because that was going to be throughout the whole movie. And if that would have been bad, it would have looked so phony that you wouldn't have been able to stick with the story.
Now, I remember you make this walk down the hall there, and as you come out the door, I remember when we were shooting it, you're really pushing the breath. It was cold, but you just, there you go. You're really selling
that. Might have started with a cigarette there. I don't know. Might have started with one smoke. Before.
You're still pushing it pretty good. I like that. And now you see what we don't see yet, and we're about to introduce that element for Dysart's going to come down and track back.
That's great.
There we are, revealing the block of ice, and again, a beautiful set.
James Arness's bed. It was a great set, wasn't it?
Another pullback situation. Yes, it was, and extremely beautifully done. This was perceived at the time to be a film that was, I don't know what the word is, cruel or something, but I think maybe more... It was a somber, serious film. There wasn't the kind of humor that you began to see in action movies and horror films. It wasn't jokes. We were taking the characters and the story extremely seriously.
Yeah, that's right. It was in a time before that seemed to become prevalent in these kinds of scary movies. That even in some of the ones that you had done and when Escape from New York, where there was a little bit of humor, this one had very, very little. It has one of my favorites ever in a movie when that guy's crawling away. We'll see that later on. But
the characters, you know, like your character didn't make any ironic asides to the audience or say kind of heroic lines. We all played it and committed to being very believable. We rehearsed the actors. You know, we remember we had rehearsals for 2 weeks where we would play the scenes. And
it was an intimate story. It was such a... Wasn't it? I mean,
it was
such a small, intimate story that
It was a story about claustrophobia. It was a story about men, and I really enjoyed the fact that it was all a men involved.
Yeah, that was interesting too because it was an all male crew except for Candy, I think her name was.
That's
who was pregnant, and she had to leave the show because she was pregnant, and that was basically an all male crew.
All of us, and I won't discuss.
It just created an interesting situation, though, I thought, because there was no posturing of any kind, because there was nobody to posture for.
No, we were all pretty equal on the show.
Yeah, it was very interesting.
So now we're bringing in the corpse of the thing, and now I thought that Rob did a pretty good job with this creation. We had to use old-fashioned A and B smoke on this, which is incredibly hard to deal with. As you can see, Will Brimley reacting. He's being truthful in his reaction.
I was going to say, this is one of those scenes, too, where it's an eight-man acting contest. Who can act like it smells the worst? And everybody was thinking that. And then when he pulled that thing off, it was pretty rugged.
And yet you guys are still there. You're still
hanging
over it. Because this smoke is extremely pungent. They've changed it now in these sensitive times when people can't handle cigarette smoke anymore. So
is the AV smoke a little more politically correct in terms of being able to breathe it?
But I remember as a director, this was one of my biggest challenges because I saw you 11 actors with dialogue and scenes, and I just started wanting to run the other direction. I didn't know quite how to do it. I learned.
Isn't it the toughest thing there is to do as a director, to take...
The worst.
9 or 10 people around a table.
It's the worst.
For 5, 6, 7 minutes and be able to make the audience remain interested in what they're saying.
That was what's so stunning about the way the first movie was done. They had I watched it again, they had a 36 shot. They had 36 people in a shot. And there's a meaningful look from you there. Interesting, how long did it take you to grow that hair and
beard? Yeah, it was a long time. I was a year or so because... I think the last movie I'd done was Escape.
I had it already.
But I had to cut it. I remember I did that play, and I had to cut it short.
That was after.
Or I guess that was after this,
that was
wasn't
after
it?
The thing.
That's right. So it was in between that.
So Tommy Waits is not paying enough attention to getting his message across. We start to learn that no one is listening to them. Their storms have shut everything down. and they're doing autopsies. We're about to cut to one of the delicious shots that the audience was repulsed by. Basically, what you have is a kind of a rubber creature where Brimley reaches in and pulls out some fresh liver. Brimley, having been a real cowboy, had no problem and was trying to tell us what it's like to...
He's just skinning a deer there.
That's it. That's basically all there is. He's just skinning a deer. Look at how he sells it. He kind of squishes it around and brings it out.
Atta boy, Will. It's really true, though. I can remember at this time the audience was beginning to have a tough time.
And basically, when we get to the dog sequence, they really had a tough time. The dog sequence drove a lot of people nuts. There he goes. Now he's really selling it for you. But Will loved his character.
Reality too. I mean, well, what is good about that is without that shot, this doesn't have the doesn't hold the same punch that the.
And you've got to take this stuff seriously, I feel, in order to make this movie something more than just a kind of a creaky monster movie. And basically, what you've got in monster films is that you have a guy in a suit. You end up there. Right. You end up in some technique, and I wanted to do a movie where you didn't have that.
Right.
Well, this was a real creature. Now, also, Kurt, at the same time, there's a little article in the paper I remember reading about some kind of new disease that was occurring.
That's right.
It was called AIDS.
Yeah, it was.
And
just...
people were dying, and it was a very weirdly similar in dynamic to what we were doing because you couldn't tell.
That's
who
right.
had it.
That's right. It was just the beginning of AIDS being discovered in the press, and it really was spooky because they didn't know what was causing it. They didn't know who had it. They didn't know how somebody got it. And
you would actually have to do a blood test to find out, which is what your character eventually does in the picture. So now we're about to get into the dog sequence, which is the first time we really show Strut the Thing's stuff and show that it's...
I love all the interplay here of some of these guys. You know, you just noticed Charlie looking at the dog kind of strangely, and everybody had their own little thing where they gave you a little bit of story just sometimes with the way they behaved.
Because the actors, you guys were so committed to character. You were so committed to telling the story. This was a difficult sequence to shoot because anytime you have a bunch of dogs and you introduce this dog, who is a tremendous acting dog, Jed, he comes in and he's pausing at all times, his trainers. Now, the other dogs, to keep them still while he walks in, it was a big feat. They would want to jump up and bark. And we're trying to get him in the position of the phony rubber dog, which...
I can remember lighting was real important here, too, wasn't it? Because of what you were about to get into.
The phony dogs always... The fur doesn't look real.
Yeah.
And I'll show you when you cut to it. If you look really carefully, you can tell it's a... that's a real dog. That's not. And, of course, it's a wide shot. It works. But now, in a second, we'll cut to another phony dog shot. These are the dogs reacting. That's a phony dog. We had to take the light off it. And there's a phony dog. Because the fur doesn't work.
Mm-hmm.
But now we're going to start to... that's a real.
Yeah, this is good.
And now they all start barking. We're going to start into our effects. Oh, boy. Here we go. Crack it open.
I love this because now that time has passed, you can look at this and you can see some of where the monster has, or the monster, some of where the organism has, what other planets it's been to, what was there, what was on those planets, what did it run into that it had to imitate?
And it's imitated every life form it's been, encountered, so who knows? I mean, that it becomes a crab worm dog with its head split open. It's pretty bizarre. And now it's going to shoot carbapol at the other dog. Basically, that's the stuff in Twinkies, and it's really fairly harmless. It looks worse than it is, but it splash-o. Yeah. The poor little dog wanted to get out of there quick. But we had the Humane Society with us, and of course, now Masser comes in, and we do a cheap trick where we throw a dog on him and try to get the audience to be scared. But the tentacles that you see moving around in a minute are actually whips that Rob Bottin is operating, much like Indiana Jones. Great lighting in this set because you couldn't show. You wanted to see nothing, and yet here it comes. Bang, now.
Yeah.
There it goes. Cheap trick. Off to go the dogs. And here come the whips. Rob is, there he goes. He's doing a good job with it, too. Pulling the whips back in. We used a lot of reverse motion technology, all sorts of things. And you hear this inhuman scream and decide operate the...
Something's up. Playing on his mind. That's why he's up here. That's right. He's
getting
he's
the beer.
Trying to figure out what's going on. That doesn't sound right. We figured he had kind of an early suspicion that something very, very, very wrong was taking place, right?
And he was right.
Yeah, he turned out to be right.
And I love the way you played this character, which was extremely real and a kind of low-key guy. I thought he was really terrific. Took charge when it needed to be done, but...
That was a fun idea, too, of getting to play a character who was not Mr. Fabulous from the top, wasn't Mr. Big, he wasn't the guy who was going to take care of the situation. He was somebody who was going to be sort of forced into it.
And yet he's an extremely reasonable man.
But he
later,
just, yeah. Just
he has to it. He has to do what he has to do. So we're about to see some more trick effects. Now some of the Stan Winston effects are about to take place. That's when Rob was busy trying to pull off the schedule. He asked Stan to come in and do this particular monster, which worked out pretty well.
That's great.
We shot this much later, much later in the schedule. And there are a lot of folks underneath the set operating this whole thing.
Of course, we're looking at black gobos there with big white X's on them.
You guys are seeing nothing.
We're seeing nothing.
And this is a reverse shot. We actually pull the tentacles in. That's a pretty horrible little reverse shot here of a phony dog getting covered. And off you go.
Let's try the shotgun first.
And that's pretty good. Shoots a little goo out. We discovered that the audience would accept yellow goo or purple goo, but not blood. They got upset if the thing was too red.
That was a tough moment for Masser, I think, having to stop me from shooting whatever this was. I mean, you gotta be kidding. Look at that.
He goes the hands up to the ceiling to blast through, and this was, I remember, the first time we ever used the real flamethrower on the set. We had two models, mm-hmm. one that wouldn't shoot and one that would, and Keith David's running in to save the day, and he actually gives it a blast with a real one. We were all rather nervous about this. And here comes a very strange, the eyeballs in it that are opening up. And
It's pretty tight quarters here, because if he turns any direction with that thing while it's on, you weren't going to have time to get out of the way.
That's correct.
Look at that. Now, I love that plant, because that was some other planet.
And now we set the set on fire, and then you guys run in and put it out. And as a matter of fact, you played a practical joke on me one day after you had used the flamethrower. After lunch, there you were standing with bandages on your face and the crew around you, and you said, "John, I got burned, man. I can't work anymore today." I had to stare at everybody's face to see where they... I know they're kidding me, but where is it? I don't. Everybody was pretty good.
It was a pretty elaborate scheme. It took getting to the whole crew and half an hour
great.
Makeup.
It was great. You look like the Invisible Man, just these eyes showing. It was fantastic. So now we've discovered, the audience and the characters have discovered that, in fact, we're in deep trouble here. And they're going to try to figure out what to do. Will, I think, his favorite moment in the film was opening this up and pulling out the thing underneath. He really got into being a biologist.
Yeah.
He wanted to play a character who was very straightforward with what he was doing, and he just brought all his cowboy experiences to it.
Oh boy!
He told me, "Al, you know it stinks when you open those things up." I once asked Will when he was doing a scene. I said, "Boy, that's an incredible performance." I said, "What are you thinking about?" He says, "Oh, like picking up my laundry."
Look at this thing. What was this? It was just a
sculpture.
Just a sculpture, yeah.
And wrapped around it is basically, it's like foam rubber. And we're pulling it off to reveal another thing underneath. It's like a Chinese boxes. You keep opening them up and there's something more underneath there. And we're going to go to the sequence where...
you see, what we're talking about here is an organism.
Time cut, but Brimley's explaining the imitation. And we found it really difficult to get across to the audience something that's rather simple, which is the life cycle of this creature, that it can imitate you, and one organism can become the entire world.
And again, it's a scene for you that you had to do with 12 people standing around a table after the previous scene of 12 people standing around a table, and you got to somehow make it interesting for the audience and different. This to me is would be the most difficult stuff as a director. I just don't know what I'd do here. I always was fascinated to watch and see how you were going to break this up, how you're going to move the camera and stuff, because there's just nowhere to go.
There's nowhere to go, and it's thankless kind of stuff. Now, this is a scene with Richard Masser and Will Brimley, and Brimley's performance here is just incredible. His subtlety and his fear and his suspicion that something is going on, and Masser's very low-key indication that maybe I'm appear to be is the beginning
it's
of
really
our,
where the movie started. Really,
our movie begins. Yeah. We really could have begun the movie here, I suppose, by starting the film with a discussion of the creature and then having this happen, but...
It is the subtlety of the playing here that...
It's the acting.
Let the audience
It's the character.
Wait a minute, this is just starting to fall apart. One guy's getting suspicious of another and the other guy's getting real defensive about it.
Why are you looking at me? No reason, no reason at all.
I don't know, it's probably nothing.
And... We begin to kind of pile up the story now a little bit because we're looking at videotapes of the Norwegian camp. I'm there someplace in that videotape somewhere. This is something we shot up in British Columbia. Basically, the backstory of unearthing the saucer. And there we go. I don't know where
this was the expedition of the Norwegians.
That's right, and in black and white. And there's Norbert up there. Where'd they take and we're going to dig and seems like they were spending a lot plant charges and so forth. And
there's Donald Moffat and Joel, and
Peter Maloney in the
Peter
background.
Maloney there.
This was a matte painting.
That was great.
Trying to show the saucer under the ground. This was a Whitlock special. And then the explosion that comes in a little bit is another Whitlock special. It was great that he was able to come through for us. And we're basically, there we go. There we go. And then it kind of fades around a little bit. And you're on your way here for a helicopter sequence to find out what went on. So now we're getting ready for the helicopter trip to the giant crater, which holds the flying saucer. Here we are again up in the Alaskan ice fields above Juneau, and you're flying along, or someone that looks like you is flying along. Very beautiful shot here. And we're on our way to basically a matte-painted sequence that we put together. Albert Whitlock oversaw it.
Now, we're on a gimbal for that shot, or is that... Are we up there 100 feet off the ground?
Actually, we were on a mountain. We punched into the top of a mountain for that particular shot. Now we're back to our second unit, and we're landing. This is extremely beautiful music by Ennio Morricone through this area. I felt that he really brought something. They were on top of this mountain. Actually, you're getting out into the snow, but the helicopter's bouncing around. Now that's a second unit shot. The music is really stunning through here. It gives you a sense of foreboding and dread. Now you're coming up and looking down a real glacier.
This was amazing because, as I remember this was about 400 feet above the ground, and if we didn't know exactly where that next step was, you literally couldn't tell the difference between the next step and 500 feet down.
And you would have been gone, yeah.
It was very strange.
And now you're throwing over ropes, but actually people who look a great deal like you are going to be climbing down. There you guys are. That's a real cliff you're on that they're on there starting down, but it's matte painted in the front. The entire saucer. Here they go. Down they come.
That ice was hard.
Boy, oh boy.
I was amazed. I got to go down one time with Lawrence there in the helicopter, down, about 1,000 feet in between two glaciers, and it was fascinating. It was spooky.
Now, Charlie Hallahan's going to describe how long this saucer has been in the ice here, and that the backscatter effect has been melting it down. Great hat, Kurt.
Yeah, just I was going to say, that kind of commands the scene, doesn't it? It's a scene about a hat and a pair of goggles.
Now, the famous studio shot that everybody talks about in this movie is coming up. That's where you have actors walking on the Universal backlot right here. walking over. We didn't have a wide shot, and this was all a painting, basically, except for the three figures. And now we're going to cut to British Columbia on our set where we dug a hole.
So that last shot was done on the lot?
On the Universal back lot, yeah. Pretty blue ice under there, huh? Mm. Amazing. Now we're into some of our night sequences, which were extremely difficult to do, and a big expository scene, which I don't like doing because I didn't quite understand how to do it. And I had a shot that dollies back and shows more of the room, and Dean Cundey was upset at me because we had to pull one of the walls. He was afraid that would violate the third wall thing. If the camera goes further than the wall, the audience knows it's a set.
I said, it's about this time, too, that as a screenwriter, you'd start worrying about the audience saying, well, why don't they just call somebody? And that's, of course, why that stuff took place earlier where the radios were going down.
And there's a lot of problems you had to solve in this movie to isolate them and be realistic. Beautiful lighting in this scene. Here's the shot I'm talking about as we come back and let Keith pull us around and pull behind Will, since he was against the wall. Dean was afraid the audience would know what we did. I said, well, it doesn't really matter.
We got to do it.
Let's do it anyway.
Now, Donald's character was he was sort of the guy in command, right? He was the leader of the pack. But
you always felt like he was slightly out of place being that leader.
He's such a good actor. He really is great. We'd done the Newland, which was a television series in the early 70s together. And I was really happy to be working with him again.
And
made great friends on this show. I made really great friends on the show, and I'd been working in the business, I remember at that point, 21 years, and they said, you know, Kurt, you got to do a play. And they talked me into it, and I did one the next year, and I was really glad I did. But these guys were a great group.
John Wash, a friend of mine from USC, who designed the graphics for Escape from New York, also designed these graphics, trying to explain the life cycle. The thing takes over one normal cell, as you can see, and we still didn't get it quite right, but it doesn't matter. And strangely, at the time, Kurt, when we previewed the movie, we got somebody on the card said that this kind of technology doesn't exist and wouldn't exist. This kind of animation graphics.
Oh, really?
In computers.
Huh.
And it's strange. Now you look at it, you see how crude it looks.
Yeah, it's crude. Looks like an old game of, what was that?
Pong.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a Pong game.
Pong. Asteroids.
I loved Asteroids.
Yeah, Asteroids is good.
Asteroids, my favorite.
Didn't we have one up there?
We had it on the set.
Yeah, we had it on the set.
Everybody played it. We put this in to explain what was happening. And basically the idea being that within a certain amount of time, the thing could take over the population of the Earth.
Right.
And the stakes then, Brimley's character, Blair, knows the stakes and does what he does next is entirely understandable. 27,000 hours from first contact. And so we're into apocalypse. I mean, we're into the end of the world unless action is taken. And so he's going to have to, he's really going to have to do something. Now, we had big discussions about whether you would know you were the thing.
Right.
I remember it got imitated.
Yeah, it got so deep as you thought about it, you'd get more and more into it, and then finally you realized you couldn't ever possibly figure out. We didn't know whether whether we would know whether we had been taken over, because it takes you over so perfectly.
So, for instance, would MacReady, if he's the thing right now, would he know he was the thing?
Yeah.
Or would he continue to act like a human being?
Right. Or would you try to hide it and pretend you're... Okay.
It was really fun to think about.
Yeah, it really was. Endless discussions about that.
Now, this interior here was actually shot up there on British Columbia on our set, in the inside of our set. We did this whole sequence up there because John Lloyd had built a little room for us. And outside is the real thing. This was rather cold. And I had done some rewriting at this point, so we wanted to clarify some of the story. Joel Polis comes up and asks you to go out in the thiocol and discuss things. And we have another little setup scene here where Bennings gets taken over. And, rather last-minute thing, because the thing was out of the movie for a while and I wanted to keep it alive.
I was going to say, you got to start thinking about that, don't you, at this point? Well, what's going on for the last few minutes?
And where are we now? He opens up, looks at the sculpture that Rob did once again. And all this was shot up there on location, so it's slightly different. We were a little bit tired and hungover by this point in the filming, so.
We were there for, what, 3.5 weeks?
It was about 3 weeks, maybe a little longer. We were trying to get home for Christmas.
That's right.
And we barely made it out.
That's a great shot there.
That old horror movie stuff where the monster is moving. And basically, the thing is still alive. They haven't discovered a way except to burn it yet, and they can't really kill it that way. So we had some tentacles. Rob gave us some rubber stuff to take up with us.
Oh, that's great.
We had to utilize it. And the next scene, exterior, you and Joel Polis are out talking. This is a rather cold but beautiful night. And
this stuff was rough.
It was pretty tough to see.
This stuff was rough because after being in the room all day, and that was the thing, is that you could never really get warm because that couldn't be warmed up because the snow would melt off the roof. So you were kind of, everybody kind of got slowed down, and I was amazed that the lenses and stuff did so well up there.
They did pretty good. We had to leave them outdoors. We couldn't bring them inside or they'd fog up.
You can never get them warm.
But you guys were, what I loved about it was the actors are always ready to go.
Yeah.
Always ready to go.
They loved this movie. They really did.
And committed to playing it and getting past the extreme difficulty of the conditions we were working under. We were all some of us were living in just huts down the hill, and we'd have to come up the mountain every day to location. And it was something else.
The ride up the hill was pretty exciting in itself. And was it 26 miles?
26 miles.
And every mile there would be a cutout where a truck could go outside because the ones barreling downhill never stopped. Couldn't stop,
right?
So they'd had those walkie-talkies, and they'd call out their checkpoints. And when they got close, the one going uphill would find the next nearest dig out.
And get in there quick. Because the truck coming down is not going to stop for you.
And to make you know that it was all true, remember, every once in a while you'd see those trucks that had gone down from falling. Look at this.
The poor guy had to take his shirt off up there in the cold and do it. So now we're getting into... what happens to Bennings? Here comes Tommy Waits running out. Joe Dante saw this at my house on tape. He said, well, you dollied over and dollied back. That's low-budget filmmaking. What is he talking about? So we're about to go out and burn Bennings.
Oh, boy, I'll never forget this. I almost got hurt on this. This is the first time. Anything like this would ever happen to me. You watch the explosion here and watch me, and you'll see. I didn't know it was going to be quite this big.
Now, is that the one where you threw the dynamite?
Yeah.
No, that's later.
Is that later on?
Yeah, this is the one where you...
We just burn him.
We just burn him. Now, those are real flares. I don't know about you, but I got my fingers burned more times on those things. So he's got some claws on, and he makes a growl. And basically, you kick over a gasoline drum and drop the torch in.
See you, Peter.
See you later, man. And we're out there in it. It's grim. It doesn't look quite so bad now, but we've got snow coming down, and it's not fun. Now you're set the dummy on fire, and good stuff. Cool stuff.
What I like about that is if that's in a different movie and you start the fire the other way, of course the can explodes. That couldn't be our problem.
This was shot at Heartland as we were doing effects. We added this to kind of clarify things and give...
And Donald's starting to go.
Starting to go a little bit. And it also shows that MacReady just takes care of business. Yep. He has a job to do, and he doesn't have time. He's accepted what some of the others can't accept.
Yep.
Here we are.
They don't want to believe the truth.
Here we are. We have to take care of business and get it done, so...
What's good about this, too, I think, is at this point the audience did believe that the people were human beings. We weren't cartoon characters. They were human lives, and it was a tough thing to have to kill another person that you've known.
That's right.
It was believable.
That's right. And I think the successful films always have that element of believability in them, no matter where they are, that you can hang on to. Here you actually give a pretty good goose with the old flamethrower there.
This is kind of fun. That flamethrower was pretty cool rig.
Yeah, I was a little afraid of having actors standing in front of me with those things. There you go.
Boy,
nice.
Gas came out of that thing.
We're burning up some phony corpses there. we had a Canadian crew with us, because our British Columbian crew we had to take with us. They were a lot of fun. They really got some good shots and with the second camera.
No women. No women in the movie. No. That was kind of, as I remember, we talked about that at the time. There hadn't been a movie for a long time that had no women in it.
Zero women. I mean, no, zero. Nowhere.
Yeah.
And we're about to get into the Blair sequence, one of my favorite scenes when Blair goes nuts and destroys the radio. I love the lighting that Dean did with the blue lights. Those were actually from airports.
Oh,
they're
right.
Airport markers. But the deep blue of them was really spooky on the snow and very pretty.
Yeah. Yeah, things are starting to turn a little more south now.
Now, Joel Polis is explaining what's going on and who he can't find. And this is a moment in the movie where we take a kind of a pause.
Trying to figure things out. Now that people are getting real suspicious, he's getting suspicious of me.
It's a bad scene.
Yeah, it starts to, the intimacy of the movie, I think, starts to really take hold here, and the fact that these guys are stuck up there together and there's nobody else around, and start to...
Now, we don't know who that is, but it is supposedly Blair, who's destroyed the helicopter so that you guys can't get any place. And he's going to destroy the radio so you can't contact anyone, because he's convinced that all of you or one of you is the thing.
That's one of those scenes where the similarities of the wardrobe worked well for the screenplay, because...
Who's who?
Who's who.
Kind of a spooky shot of a helicopter under a tarp. And we don't know why you find that flashlight, but we do find it, and so we can do this little trick here. This was a mock-up of a helicopter, not a real one, and it was way oversized. We blew it up.
This was still out there, wasn't it? This was still on location.
Uh-huh. We're still in British Columbia. Now, you heard a gunshot, and you're going to run inside, and we're
try
back.
Well,
you're doing your best.
Try to run the snow.
Nice little pantaglide shot down our set hallway, and we're into the Blair scene. This is one of my favorite scenes because of
great.
How nuts Wheels goes.
Ooh, yeah, he's serious.
Nice hit there. And then, unlike the original movie, there's not quite a scene like this where the men have to work together to try to subdue one of their own. He's just going to town in there, and poor Tommy Waits is... underneath it all. We ran two cameras on this and just let Will go for it.
It really does, this idea here of directing everybody's attention at one character.
Yeah.
Works very well.
Now, you might notice Keith's left hand, he hides behind you. he had broken it in a car accident. And it had this gigantic bandage on it, so we had to put a glove over it and paint it black so that he could continue acting.
As I remember, the only car he had driven prior to that one was a stolen car in New York City.
Ah, yes.
Oh, go for it, Will.
The Will is really going to go now. It wanted to be us, Will said, which is a very chilling line, and I just think he did a great job. Now there's going to be a... A little scuffle here in a second that Will was very worried about. He was worried about getting hurt. You can see.
He's going to have nine guys charging him.
He blasts towards Keith David there. And
you don't want to hurt anybody. I'll kill you.
Opens it up. Throws
go
the
for
gun.
It, Will. There he goes.
And here you come. Here's what he, look, watch him as he backs up. There you go. He doesn't want to get hit too hard. People go flying. Everybody loved taking their own stunts here. He was throwing things around.
Oh, boy.
Poor Tommy can't join in the fun. So we have to deal with Blair now and isolate him from the group because he's too nuts. And he gives a scene that's coming up was one of my favorites in the movie where you have to explain to him that trust is a tough thing to come by these days.
Right.
And I thought that was kind of the summation of the movie. Now you're leading Blair out to this shack where you're going to keep him. This looks like pretty terrible weather for us here, as it was during most of our shoot up there, except for a couple of nice days.
Yeah, I think this was one of the earlier shots that we did, wasn't it?
That's mm-hmm. When we got there. So they're barricading him in, and one of our famous needle shots. You know, people have told me that that bothers them more than anything else.
Now, did somebody have to volunteer for that shot?
Our camera operator, Ray Stella. He said, I can do this all day.
Ray's in rehab now, isn't he?
This is one of my favorite lines coming up here, and Blair doesn't know who to believe, doesn't know who to trust.
I don't know who to trust.
I know what you mean, Blair. Trust's a tough thing to come by these days.
Just trust in the Lord, Blair. And he starts sowing the seeds of dissent here about Clark. Watch him.
I said, watch Clark.
And in a minute, we're going to get into...
that was great, too. Did you hear
me? And really, really well done.
Yeah.
I mean, he really pulled it off. Pulled off this whole character. So we're outside again in our location here in a second, and discussing some sort of a blood test. Is there a way to take care of things? Again, one of our really bad days in terms of weather.
I remember when we looked at this halfway through the movie, or into the movie, thinking of all these guys looking the same. It was going to be very difficult to discern one person from the other. This was the scene that got everybody talking throughout the whole movie. We never figured out. You could never figure this out.
I know.
That's what you got. You and we talked about the ending of the movie for the whole movie.
So the blood test scene, actually, when Richard Dysart discovers the open bags of blood, and all the men come into the room, is probably the biggest nightmare scene for me as a director that I've had. That day I arrived on set and I found all of you there. Ready to act with lines. I had no idea what to do. I had never been confronted with that before.
Standing looking.
It was terrible. We're coming up to that scene in a moment. This is fairly easy, though. This was a limited number of people. It's still always difficult to, in the amount of time you have to make a film, to make sure that you cover a scene correctly. I probably shouldn't use the word cover, but... So here we move up to the dripping blood, and we realize now that somebody has sabotaged all their blood supply, and now we're into my nightmare scene.
And so one of them now, one of them now is bad news. Yeah, this is where the paranoia starts to really grab a hold, isn't it?
It is, and it's as you can see from the lighting, it's kind of dark and shaded slightly, and we creep to the right here with the camera and revealing Dysart, and he begins to distrust Donald Moffat, and Moffat begins to distrust everybody. It's really turned out to be a terrific scene, but did I have a clue of how to do it when I got there in the morning? No, I had no idea.
Yeah.
Well, who else could use that key?
Uh-oh.
Nobody. I just give it to Copper whenever he needs it. Could anybody have gotten it from you, Doc? I don't see how. As soon as I'm finished, I return it right away.
These guys are going at it now.
The paranoia is what kind of the glue that holds the movie together. It's, of course, I think the most disturbing thing for the audience. That's what bothered them so much. And I always felt the characters reflected their time just as Hawks' original movie, his characters reflected theirs. This is the time that we are living in.
Yeah. It really is where the movie shifts into third gear and starts on its way. There we go.
Now we have a confrontation where it's a battle for leadership, but when you have men under these conditions without leaders, just like any nation,
survival of the fittest,
it comes down to a real grim scene. And this was a difficult scene again for me to stage because of the shape of the hallway. I had a T-shape, and I had to get all of you in there.
Right.
There's only part of you in this part, and the rest of you are down the hall.
Take it easy. Put the gun down.
It seems so easy to direct movies when you're looking at them and and thinking about them. But boy, to get out and do it is tough.
That's right. The taking of the gun here was a turning point in the movie where you, this was the first, this is what we talked about the first time where you begin to see MacReady
assert himself.
Who everybody can control. Mm-hmm.
And he really doesn't particularly want control. He just wants to kind of survive the situation. So Gary gives up his command, but tries to give the gun to someone else. Clark and Childs have a little fight over it. Charlie Hallahan is not prepared to take over. He's a little too scared.
Where? Yeah, but who's it going to go to?
Goes to Norris, but Norris refuses.
I don't think I'm up to it.
I'm sorry, fellas, but I'm
not. No. Nobody wants that.
Except for your character, who I think, to me, is somebody we all need in a time of
crisis.
Except that you turn out to be someone who they suspect later.
Yep.
When this point in the movie gets gets completely claustrophobic as night hits, we really don't ever come out of it. It's a lot of doom, and we're now doing a scene that we shot up in our location that we kind of wrote when we were up there.
Burn the blood.
Burn the blood, and you give a little speech about what we have to do. This was the moment where I felt MacReady took stage and really explained to the audience what was going on in their dilemma. That was the one thing that we didn't have at that point.
That's right. Forgotten that, too.
You also came up with a final line for the movie, too.
Well, we talked about it forever and ever, didn't we? How are we going to end this story? But this scene does set that up.
And it also sets up that MacReady, for all his isolation as a character, for all his problems, is someone who is a realist. He's grasping the situation and trying to find a way out. So we're laying in, there's a storm, we're laying in that they're trapped, and kind of laying the ground rules for the last part of the picture.
You know, it's at this stage of the game where I like to look at a movie and try to, hopefully the movie's allowed you to be able to say to yourself, now, if I were there, what would I be like? What would I do? What would I be thinking? And
I think we'd all love to believe that we'd rise to the heroic moment. Yeah. I'm not so sure.
Yeah.
I think I'd probably be on the floor crying, kicking my heels. It's a pretty brisk little wind that night we had.
Yeah,
it's pretty cold material out there. I wasn't very happy with being that cold. And we're shooting up the characters with drugs and keeping the ones obviously under suspicion and drugged out. Here's another one of our famous in-your-face shots. Again, in goes the needle. In the,
is that
in,
Ray?
That's Ray again, yeah. He wanted to do every one of them. And another added scene that we put in later, where you're dictating the maybe your memoirs into this tape recorder.
And we're starting to all get real tired now, too, because we've been up for a long time.
And no one's sleeping because no one can trust. Because if you go to sleep, you're afraid that someone is going to take you over, rip your clothes to shreds, and absorb you and imitate you. And we're wondering now whether there's somebody might come in that door in the back. And yet, rather than put a shadow of a person and suspect you, I decided simply to cut to in a second.
Right.
A shot from behind. I remember dealing in my mind with the fact that is MacReady a creature or not?
Right.
For a long time, I was hoping maybe we could do something where you were.
Yes.
But then I thought, well, maybe not. I'm not so sure they want to see that. So instead, we made it ambiguous. It's not the height of technology with that little tape recorder, but he now starts to record. You do look tired and in pain almost about the situation.
Yeah, he's starting to. It's like it's starting to get to him, he's just about had it.
There's the shot.
I love those two shots. You just felt like somebody was watching somehow. That was great.
Then we're at a split diopter here, where both the character in foreground and background are in focus. Luckily, we have dark to cover it, And things are really getting serious now. Nobody trusts anybody. And Joel is about to, we're about to have lights out, and Joel is about to run outside and meet his doom. We actually had a sequence when the lights went out that we shot, but it didn't turn out as well as we wanted it to, so we kind of faked it through here.
This was part of the thing. With this look here, we tried to drag the look out on Joel a little bit to try to start to make MacReady somehow maybe suspicious here. We're looking for our little spots.
The lights go down, and we're coming down into we're in an insert stage at this point, trying to cover up some things that we cut. Now we're back on our set. The entire sequence was lit this blue, and it really didn't hold. But this is pretty interesting. A little cheap horror movie scare, and now he's outside. It's he's about to meet.
Joel is in trouble.
His doom. Joel was very excited. This was his first movie ever.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, he was from New York, and he was just having a blast. And now we lay a little suspicion here on you. Perhaps you've been absorbed.
Remember those flares when we were inside the sets at Universal?
Burn your hand, burn your lungs. It was terrible. Yeah, it looks bad to me. So now we're into it. We've got to go find out what happened. The lights were off, and you're sort of really taking charge here. People are falling apart.
Now we're going to team up here. I ain't going with Windows. <We're> gonna...
One of my favorite lines coming up from you. It was really great the way you assumed a control over the situation here. And I really felt that you were, you know, in charge of it. So in a minute, you're going to be framed for... Framed for something that isn't true, and we're going to get into one of our amazing effects sequences. At least
there would be nothing else you could do except team up and hope the guy you were with was okay. That was pretty good. We turned the Ritters on for that one.
Yes, we did. It was unpleasant enough, but we decided to get some little wind going.
He's great here.
One of my favorite scenes. This is where I think Blair wants to come back inside. He has a hangman's rope. A little touch by Bill Lancaster. Oh. And Will's performance here was hysterical. I've used it many times since.
It's so great.
I'm all better now, and I want to come back inside. Come on, man. This was actually shot on a soundstage at Universal, and you're selling that flare pretty good there, Kurt. You have it right up against your face.
I know, it's not it. I was going to say, Kurt, can you get the flare a little bit high? Well, you know, I'm doing the best I can here. Setting my beard on fire. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, well, man's got to do what he's got to do.
Now we find out what Joel Polis's fate. Fuchs ran outside and was we assume absorbed by somebody or somewhere or something. And how do we know? We see his glasses.
Right. These flares were lighting our scenes.
And by this point in the film, one wonders how these guys are going to ever get out of this. It's like this incredible disease that's spreading. But it's also their emotional state.
Right.
No one trusts anyone. Yeah, I think that's the end of Fuchs.
Now they're trying to figure out if you'd have time to commit suicide before it could take you over.
It was an interesting situation to be up in a location like this. I felt that it only helped you guys in your performances. Being up here in the...
Oh, yeah, it was great because you even when you were on the set in Los Angeles,
you're still having, you'd walk out, in between shots, you're walking outside, it was 100 degrees, so you'd be snapping in and snapping out. But what was interesting about this is, I remember we got those little sheets of paper that talked about people after they'd been in lonely situations for a long time, and their first thing would go is their appearance, and then they'd begin to steal things and whatnot. And I felt like that was happening to all the actors on the show.
Yeah, I got a little nuts.
Yeah. It did start, I mean, it didn't fall apart, but it got to be tougher and tougher and tougher.
You could understand what would happen to people down there.
Yes.
In a completely isolated like this. How crazy.
Well, there was nothing else to look at because it was all white. Everything was completely white. There was nothing to look at but the people.
And you have a kind of the inside of the set is very bland. There's nothing to see here. It's all functional. So what would happen but your face?
It was interesting. I remember some of the conversations that we had. You really find out a lot about somebody very, very quickly, and the crew, the actors, everybody.
So now we're setting up Charlie Hallahan's heart condition here, as someone is coming back from the shack up there. Now we start kicking things into another gear here after a little section of the film. With paranoia, now it's going to be, let's take some action. Yeah. In comes TK. Yes.
He did a good job being cold here, didn't he?
Yes, he did. I cut him loose on the ladder by the shack. So basically, you know, you're the man they suspect now.
Yeah.
And we're getting into one of my favorite sections of the film. From here through the blood test is I just love.
Yeah, it just keeps getting deeper and deeper now with the paranoia. And I think that it was important for the audience here to believe that it could be MacReady, and not having been someone who was take charge from the beginning really allowed you to believe that. It was such an ensemble movie.
Uh-oh. Kind of old 1930s haunted house kind of movie technique, but that's where we were at this point. And you're going to break into the storeroom and threaten them with dynamite. It was fun shooting these scenes. Everybody was so good. It was pretty easy for me to direct. Just put the camera up and say go.
Oh, then we're wrong. He's gonna die. That's what Giles is right there.
Now we had to. We had to have Keith David break through that door with an axe, and he actually went right at it. You notice everybody else is moving away slightly. You never know what's going to happen.
An axe, a car, you never know.
Actor gets something, a deadly weapon in his hand. You get frightened.
This is a great lighting in here, too, because he looked like a ghost here. Just looks like, absolutely like a ghost. Anyone messes with me and the
whole camp goes. So here you are. All bundled up with all this makeup on. It must not have been a whole lot of fun.
And it tasted like sugar on the sides of my mouth.
Hearing that flare is
and
up
it,
there.
Yeah.
You're doing a good job of kind of hiding part of it, too, except for this part where it's bald. But, boy, it looks good. It was a really nice nice job there. Yeah, you're hiding it with your body. They lifted a little bit there.
Yeah. That's right. It was a... how did that work?
Now, you just dropped it down so it didn't flare the camera lens. You know, Cundy was yelling at you all the time. Now you get jumped from the inside a little bit here, and you had this flare. We had to get rid of it quick.
Yeah.
Yep. Well, you held on to it. Oop, yeah. Good. Down he goes, but you back up. Well done. Yeah. Well done. Yeah, those flares were dripping this crap on you, and it was pretty bad. I got them all over. I got burning my flesh on my hands.
Yeah, because you're anywhere near them.
And it wasn't fun at all. And you breathe this stuff, and it makes you want to give up and go home.
And then I remember that too. They lasted for about 90 seconds.
And then they're out.
And then you had to pick the scene up.
And do it again.
Or try to do it a little faster. Try to get one more line in.
Kirk, can you say that a little faster this time? Now we're into the scene where they're trying to resuscitate Norris on the table and into one of our effects scenes. It's probably the most, as far as I'm concerned, one of the craziest done.
This when people still talk about this one, they I worked with Charlie Hallahan just a couple of weeks ago, and he said that of all the movies he's done, this is the one. This is the scene that they talked to him about. It's really something.
Rather than give all the secrets away of the thing, I will just tell you that everything you see that we do here is all basically built and on the set in front of us. It was nothing that we'd put in later.
And Charlie had to lay down and not move for eight hours?
8 hours.
8 hours for makeup. For this one. Was two shots?
He had to do it twice. I'll show you the shot. He had to lay down there, and his chest had to open up, coming up here in a second. Now he's doing it normally now. The next, it's coming up here in just as Dysart, right there.
Whoa!
Bango. Yep.
Oh,
yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Whoa, boy.
Yep.
There he goes. Oh, Jesus. I love this one. Look at that.
Pretty disgusting, isn't it?
Oh, man.
It's Larry Franco stepping in for you there.
Yeah.
And you're about to blast it.
Blastola.
And here we go. Stretch with the neck.
Oh, yeah. This is the best line of the movie coming up.
He pulls, the head moves away and goes down to the floor.
Just wild.
This was all on an insert stage later after we'd finished the picture. And so we shot you here shooting away and burning earlier, and then we put this in later.
Look at this.
This is a reverse action cut as it finds something to grab onto. And you're letting the thing burn up, which I think is probably a very good idea. And the head crawls across the... pulls itself across the floor. It's about to grow some other appendages and start to move in a minute, which is, I think, a kind of an incredibly genius idea. Rob came up with this stuff, and it's, okay, man, let's give it a shot.
It's just wild, and it is. It's just, when you've got the same, theoretically the same gag that you're going to do over and over, how do you keep making it different? Look at that.
This is all operated from underneath. It's a phony floor, and we're just pushing everything out.
Now we're trying to hold everything together at the same time we're trying to tear it apart. This line here is my favorite.
It's pretty bizarre. I never have seen anything like this in a movie before or after. Now we have a little radio control thing in the background that's crawling away.
Yeah, this
and here he comes.
You gotta be fucking kidding.
Oh, man.
And that's another one of those live flame bursts that you did.
Yeah.
And then we put the set on fire once again. Two cameras running. The one out there's the one in the hall that's picking it up. That's quite a little baby there.
How'd you do those sound effects? What was the, what would you use?
I have no idea. Here we are in my favorite scene. Kurt, this is the reason I wanted to make this movie was the blood test scene.
The blood test scene.
I really liked the conclusion that MacReady came to, and I liked the build-up. It starts earlier before everyone's tied up, and Clark gets his comeuppance. We had to be real careful with this. When he charges you, you had to shoot him point blank.
Yep.
So we used a quarter load, as I remember, but still, we were all really worried.
And it was a headshot, wasn't it?
Yes, it was.
Yeah.
And he was right next to you.
This is great, because this is where they were getting down to it.
I mean it.
Real dramatic moment, and we're going to do this in one quickie. Bang!
That was tough.
Yeah, I was really worried about it.
Yeah.
But it worked out.
Yeah, it was tough. And again, you know, that testing the blood thing, it does remind me now that it makes you politically think about things like, as AIDS was coming into the world at that time, identifying as quickly and as succinctly as possible.
It really brings it up, and you think about it. I mean, in this case, identifying who the creature is a moment of surviving and living, and it's about life.
And yeah, we're beginning to understand, too, that thing just wants to survive, and it's an organism. It's just like us. We could go to another planet and eat plants, and from the plant's point of view...
That's
this
right.
Horrendous-looking monster.
And the issue that MacReady comes up with, which I like, is that he realizes that there is no individuality in this creature.
Right.
That every cell is an individual on its own surviving, and it has no feelings of wanting to work for a group. It doesn't have any instincts above its own survival, and he figures out that if the blood screams, well, guess what? You're a creature. Now, we spent a long time shooting this scene.
God, this was hard because of the way the stuff was rigged up.
Yep. And this got everybody, too, in the audience. They couldn't stand the phony blood on the knife. I never could understand this. I thought...
Yeah, it's just the cutting. I know. These simple little things after. I guess it's some sort of... I would say in the same area of comic relief, it's like if you're set up by other scenes to make you feel a certain way, then you do some little thing, and it has great impact.
I think it's the sound effect here. I mean, he has a tube on the back of that thing, guys. It's not a big deal. And there it goes. It looked kind of silly when you think about it, but people got... they wussed out on us and got real
It did. All these things did pile up on the audience. I remember the time they just
they were shook. They were shook by it. And one of the reviews... I, at the time, called me a pornographer of violence. Made me think about my career then.
Yeah, right.
Well, I don't know what I'm going to do
actually
now.
When you look at it, I mean, I think it's done very subtly. I mean, it really is. It's not. I mean, the monster is so insane that it seemed easy to me to get past the monster and into the story of paranoia. But at the time, it didn't.
It was they criticized us for not having women.
Yeah.
For all being all men.
Right.
And they criticized us for having a lack of hope.
They haven't found a they haven't found a cure here yet at this point.
No, and I always felt that there was something uplifting about these men who were
trying,
struggling, and then in the end willing to give their own lives to stop it from spreading
at least that would give it a chance. And, of course, I always thought that at the end, when we see that, too, it'll remind me of it. But they couldn't let each other, they couldn't let both of them die without being burned. So one of these guys was going to either have to make a move or torch each other if they were truly going to save the world. And I don't know if that was, you and I could never figure out if that
how to do it. Yep. Yep. So we're finding out that a lot of people are human. And we're wondering now about your hypothesis that the blood's going to do anything. Yeah. No one really believes you at this point. Now that is
this is great.
At this point, I suppose we can tell it now. That's a phony hand with our gag already set up, and I wanted to establish it in a cut early so that you wouldn't think about it.
Right. Right.
And because it is definitely a phony hand. And we had that's phony baloney. And we're about to crank this baby here and get going. Django.
Whoa! Hello.
And we tilt the table to make the blood run. And here he goes. Now, this transformation wasn't quite what we wanted, but you know what? It worked out all right.
Oh, this is great.
Somehow you're...
it was jammed. We had to come up with that, too, because
yes, we did.
Why would he just sit there?
And we had to come up with a lot of stuff.
Look at this.
And very quickly cut, so you can't really see what's going on. You know, up he goes.
Boom. That was great.
He comes back down again. Now, we had this creature that Rob brought us.
Look at that.
It splits open and wraps puts his head in, and up he goes.
Just ate his
hand. We just shoot it every way we could.
It is completely crazy.
It's nuts.
It's crazy.
It's a nightmare. It really is a vision of hell, as far as I'm concerned. I wouldn't. I mean,
can you imagine this?
If this was happening in front of me in reality, I would say, well, I guess that's about it.
Oh, he's been.
It's all slimed, baby.
There you got it.
And now we do the burn.
Now this was reminiscent of...
This is like the first one.
The first one, yeah.
But
I rather didn't enjoy this. We had to do it twice because...
Yeah, this was tough. Was that Dick Warlock?
No, that was Tony Ciceri. And goes outside. Now we had to... There we go. Outside. This is.
Oh, yeah.
This, when you threw the dynamite here...
Oh, brother, I want to tell you something. That woke me up in a hurry.
You weren't ready for this explosion.
It was over before it happened.
Watch yourself now as you throw this. Back there.
Whammo, oh, man. It went right by me. I mean, I felt stuff go through me on that. I was just lucky.
Of course, that reaction was
taken. Oh, yeah. This is days later. That was a retake. Get calmed down.
Now, we actually have we have some people on the other side of this wall who are operating the hands and legs on sticks.
Oh, this was tough, too, because you're burning a guy who's still a human being.
And you're setting them on fire, and these guys behind the wall are, basically, the wall's on fire. Yeah. They're still operating the puppet. So they didn't enjoy it.
The sound effects were great there. They're kind of like a baby or something.
Uh-huh. Now we're going to finish up the blood test and really find out here who's left that's a creature.
And now that's great. That's...
And there's we're down to two. And I thought that summarizing the entire situation was Donald Moffat's last line.
Yeah.
I thought he did a great job with it. Now, Keith David wants to get away from Donald here.
Get me the hell. Come on, get me out of here. Come on, get me out of here. Get me loose, damn it.
Now, he's the last one.
That's a great kind of it. Oh, boy.
And here comes the end of the blood test, and I must say I was very, very happy with how the scene turned out. Here comes Donald's line. I thought, well, if you guys, the audience doesn't want comic relief, I mean, here it is for you. Time.
I'd rather not spend the rest of this winter tied to this.
Kind of a perfect summation.
Oh, that was great.
So now we're into the, basically the final act of our picture here where you're going to go out and test Will Brimley. And things are going to start to happen, and we're going to get even grimmer than we have been.
Right. Now the stage is set, so there's only one more to find out about.
As long as you guys could stay together, you're pretty clear. Now that's a Ritter scene at night with wind blowing.
Oh, that was, and it was blowing. It was hard to walk up that thing, I remember.
Then we're into a set on at Universal. This was built, for obvious reasons obvious in a moment, it was built up a story. And Blair is gone, the door is open, but we discover underneath his shack where Blair is in fact a thing and has been building something kind of amazing.
Out of whatever he had in that shack.
And the heli parts of the helicopter. And again, another ingenious set by John Lloyd, who just did a brilliant job on the movie.
This is great.
And the colors, the set design and the costume design, we try to do a black and white movie in color. In other words, there are really no strong colors. Everything is very muted. And
of course, this is one of those who's going to go down the hole first deals.
Down goes the commander. Actually, this was
he was reassuming control, actually. He was sort of reassuming control.
Uh-huh. Now we're down into our little set under here that...
oh, boy.
And, again, it's not fun to creep down this with those flares. They really are... You couldn't breathe back up in that tunnel particularly well, and...
Oh, that was...
And it's a refrigerated stage, so we're trying to sell the breath and... all in all, it wasn't a very fun physical experience.
It really was exhausting. After a whole day of that, you'd be really tired, and then the next day was more of the same. And
you go home to the wife, they don't understand. Well, what's wrong, honey? Why don't you want to go out? Oh, I'm dead, man. I'm dead.
It, you know, It was also one of those movies where you begin to you talk back to that. Was that John Wayne movie where they figured everybody on the set got cancer because of some asbestos
the
or
Conqueror.
Something?
It was, yeah,
Conqueror.
Yeah.
And we begin to say, well, I can remember exactly when I got it. It was on the thing.
And now we're showing you back in the compound that, in fact, something else has happened there with Childs. He was actually standing guard, and now the door is open and he is gone. So things are getting really grim here. We're going to blow up the saucer and actually, this is the kamikaze mission coming up. This is the suicide mission. We're going to shut the place down. Ooh, that looks grim. And out comes Childs, who staggers around. We don't know quite what's going on here. Now the lights are going to go off. When the lights go off, it's going to be all blue and dark. The generator is shut down. I still can't decide whether Childs was a creature or not.
I know. I thought that was...
I cannot decide.
Yeah, there was no way of telling and no way of ever knowing. The only question you could say was, why did he leave his post?
And now the decision is made. You're going to freeze very quickly. And you would, too. In reality, it wouldn't be long, and you guys would be toast. All you could do is start setting fire to your own surroundings.
After that thing, yeah.
Again, you're acting with this flair and doing a very good job of not burning yourself with it. I mean, what we all wanted you to do was get it close enough to your face still, and yet not too close. In a moment, we're going to have the tractor. We're going to blow up the shed first. And blowing up this camp was an experience I'll never forget.
Yeah,
I'll never forget it as long as I live. I could not believe what it felt like to blow shacks that big.
This is also in the movie where you, a long way from the end, you've told the audience it ain't going to be a happy ending. Ka-wham.
Those all remote cameras doing a lot of this. That one was nothing compared to what's coming up. We're really going to blow this whole place to smithereens. And now in comes a tractor, and someone who looks a lot like you is driving it. Ka-woom! As it goes through the stage floor into the sub-basement below our floor and kind of gets stuck. And now you guys, the three of you, are going to set fire to our stages at Universal on the inside, right. Which was not... Well, I had a little questions about that. We had the fire department standing by and fire extinguishers, but still, you'd hate to be responsible for burning down Burbank.
And that cuts in between outside and inside here. This outside stuff coming in was... this Boom. Outside stuff, look at that.
It went.
And I remember now everybody up when we were in Alaska talking about, you know, what if this thing's a little stronger than they figured, that doesn't really go up too good. You're going to have to go back next day. What were you going to do if that explosion would have just sort of half done? I guess you'd have to live with it.
You'd have to live with it or try a special effect.
Yeah, special effect.
Put over an explosion or something. We were actually blowing these rooms and moving down this hallway. And now we finally got it done. Now we've set the whole thing on fire in that shot, and we're coming over to you guys. And you're going to go down into one of our prettiest sets, which is the basement below everything, where the generator is. And I thought John Lloyd did an incredible job with this. And Dean Cundey's lighting was extraordinary. You're dealing with only fires and those flares that you're carrying. And he just did an incredible job. This is an amazing sequence.
This was being shot in sequence, John, or was this? I don't remember now. This we shot before we went up to Alaska.
That's right. Yeah, we shot all our interiors, and then we went up. Now that's a sound stage with this whole underground built and refrigerated.
Yeah.
And the steam coming out and the
flares and
smoke. It really was unpleasant, but looked beautiful for us. We have water dripping down as the place is melting. And actually, it was a very, very big set. These little tunnels go in various places.
It was a weird scene, too, because, you know, these three guys are now in their coffin, getting ready to do themselves in.
I always thought this was a whole lot like an old World War II picture where, you know, you had to carry out the mission because for a greater cause. And I felt...
It's gone, McCready.
The voice of doom.
Oh, boy.
And we're going to find out in a moment what happened to Blair. He's going to make a brief reappearance. Originally in the script, I believe he didn't, but
yeah, that's right. You brought him back.
We brought him back just to let the audience know that he was in fact a creature.
Again, you think about this, and you'd hate to be one of those three guys, wouldn't you, knowing that.
What are you going to do?
What are you going to do? You're dead.
Now we're into a really neat part of the set, which we assume that this area has, you know, gotten so cold, and this is the junk that they've put in there. And really, everything is lit by the helmet he's wearing, and it's very moody. And
great spook coming up here, huh?
This was the scene in which I asked Will Brimley what he was thinking, and he said picking up his laundry as an actor. Which gave me some insight into him. But, you know, he takes his job very seriously, and he's a really terrific actor.
That is great.
And around the corner he comes, no cheap horror movie scare. Reverse shot, done with Donald.
Look at that.
And that's the laundry scene.
Look at that.
That's actually Rob Bottin's hand and Donald Moffat's face. It wasn't the most fun to do, but Donald was an old trooper and really a pro.
Went out in style.
Pay it off, or that's the end of that. And now we assume that Blair has really mutated now. And in a moment, we're going to get into the charge of the thing under the boards. And
that was a little tough to do because
it wasn't easy, was it?
It wasn't easy that thing because there was no way to rehearse it.
Nope, we just had to do it.
We had to do it and keep running.
Now TK disappears here, and you're all alone. And
dump, dump.
I always thought this particular period through here where we took a beat and you're ready to blow the place, and it was really nice. You don't know what's back there, and the Cundy's lighting is just sort of suggesting little things, and it's what's in your mind more than anything else. And I suppose if I could have gotten that hat back on your head, I would have been happy.
Thanks. I do appreciate that. I never let it go, though. It wasn't leaving me.
And basically we had a track built under the set with a big ball that was compound roped off and pulled. That's actually, I believe that's Dick Warlock preparing for his stunt.
This was so weird because there was no way to rehearse it.
Here it comes.
Here it comes.
Multiple cameras coming towards you. Here goes Warlock and takes a dive. You land. And up comes animated Randy Cook animated a creature here, and we ended up using parts of that part there, and this blast up, and then we cut to our biggest monster effect. 50 people were operating this from underneath, and it was a last minute thing.
The big boy.
And out comes the dog. We were
now,
kind of.
Do they all come out here?
Kind of. There's a dog, and then there's a half monster, and it's Blair, and it was pretty big.
There's the Blair man. Yeah.
This was a tough one. It took us quite a bit to get it done. Nice tuck and roll.
Yeah.
And
this was. And what do we say here? I remember this one too. Yeah. What should we say here?
My sentiments exactly. And up goes the entire camp.
Whoosh!
We were way away from this camp, and the size of the explosion was something I had never seen before. These are remote cameras that are photographing it from the ground, and there would be no way we could be there.
Boy, those explosions happen quick. They really...
And then they're over.
Look at that. That so now, was the last day. Was that the? That must have been the last night.
Well, right? Remember, we had to reshoot this as the Norwegian camp
that's
when
right.
you arrived to it. So
that's right.
Now we're into the final moments of the movie, which we discussed and talked about, and
we just didn't know. We said, "If you do, you know if you're the thing. Does it know if it knows that you know you're the thing?" And on and on and on. And how would you stop it?
And as a director, you know, you would say to me, these guys can't let themselves live, John. They have to kill each other. And I would think to myself, well, I can't have you two burn each other as the end of my picture. So you came up with a final moment. The studio originally wanted to find out what would happen if you didn't reintroduce Chiles. So they had me preview a scene where you cut right there.
And wasn't there some talk about bringing helicopter? A helicopter comes in. They've arrived, and you don't know that.
And that wasn't There's, it, guys. We have to end it with our guys.
It was generic. The ending is generic to what the movie's about.
You have to finish off their story and tell their story, and that's it. And where were you, Chiles? I thought your ending line. I thought this entire ending of the movie was incredible. It would be. It would be what I would want and. I was extremely happy with it.
That's where he explained what he was doing, looking for Blair. He saw Blair and he was walking by. So everybody was perfectly set up. The only thing we did know at this point was that MacReady was not, right?
Didn't he could have been.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Here we go again.
I mean, he was just, we didn't see him for a while. And it was a great, you guys did a great job here, I thought, just really playing this moment out.
Oh yeah, they had to have the
eight. You worried about me. We've got any
surprises for you. And as the light is kind of getting darker and darker on you,
I don't think we're in much shape to do anything.
The two men are going to freeze or die or something.
They both got a weapon. They can kill each other. What are we going to do?
What do we do? Why don't we just?
And I thought the great line and. You know what? I'm extremely proud of the film. I think we pulled off a movie that's lasted longer than we may have all thought.
Yeah.
And it's been kind of fun to sit and relive it.
It's fun. It is to bring it back again, and I it's fun to see this movie and remember. You know, it's funny when people watch the movie. That's what they have, and interestingly enough, we can never have that experience because we made it. But what we do have that nobody else has was the making of it, and that's the great joy.
Yeah, there's a lot of joy in the whole process of making movies, just kind of being there and going through it all together. Especially in this case, we all bonded as cast and crew, and really worked hard to make the best picture we could at the time, and the experiences that we all remember now. Are really our reward for the film. You know, it's like a kid. You do the best you can with
That's
it.
That's right.
You send it out into the world, and sometimes it does okay, and sometimes it doesn't. But
you got to finally throw it out there, and it lives on its own. And it was disappointing. I remember at the time, to watch the movie not do well in the theater. But I must say, over the last 13 years now, it has been a great pleasure to have people come. It's movies that you do like this that you put a lot into and you had a lot of feeling and you thought it was a really good movie. When people come up to you on the street and they say, "Hey, The Thing."
I know, that's a great feeling,
isn't
it?
It's a great feeling. Yeah, it really is. You know, Von Ryan's Express. If just one person enjoys it, then you feel like you.
This was a fairly apocalyptic film, and it did have a downbeat, or I guess you could call it an ambiguous ending, but that was the ending for our picture. You know, you can't really order up a happy ending when you're dealing with something like this. I suppose we could have changed it and have one of you become the thing, and you could have burned him and then walked off like the lone cowboy.
It's such a great story. Who's going to win? If we go to another planet, we are trying to survive as a species. If we end up having to go to another planet to try to do that, we certainly hope that we survive.
And absolutely.
That one was simply doing the same thing.
It was doing the same exact thing.
And who's to say? I guess we'll just have to wait and see what happens. Hopefully it'll be us.
This was my first film for a big studio. And
That's right.
I had never done what I had done independent films up to then. I had done TV movies. And what I found to be the most incredible part of making a studio film was the amount of set, and I don't know how to put it, the amount of professionalism that you could put into a scene that you were doing just far outweighs the kind of creative quickness that you had to do on the street when you're making a film. We really, to do that blood test scene, we really had to involve acting, sets, costumes, special effects.
Right. You couldn't do that with a small...
It would be very difficult. It would be very difficult to get it as good as we had it. You know, the studio was behind us, and we had a team of people who were very, very good, and fantastic actors. The special effects were amazing.
Oh, they were great.
And it's putting it all together and unifying it so it looks like a whole piece. That's what the studio can give you. If they're for you and they support what you're doing, there's nothing better.
I was going to say, that's what you have to have, though, because if it isn't that, it just makes you want to go back with that small crew.
That's
that
right.
Small camera
and have a blast again.
And have a hell of a time.
And that's the other side of it. If they're not for you and you're playing political games, then it can be real hell. But it's terrific, the people that we worked with, and looking at it again, it just makes me all the more proud of the film, and I just love sitting here with you and talking about it.
I know, it's a blast. It's fun to see these with you again. We got to do this with Escape from New York, and I hope we do get to do it with Big Trouble in Little China,
because
I think that's another film that took a special kind of sense of humor at the time to enjoy.
That's right. Oh, I think that movie is terrific.
But this, seeing this again does bring all those memories back, and the fabulous time we had, and the great time that I had making a movie with you, and they can't take that away from me.
Never. So listen, guys, we'll see you at the movies, and thanks for watching.